And joining us now on Hot Copy, we have with us Pastor Apollo Quiboloy's lawyer, Attorney Elvis Balayan. Good morning, Attorney. Glad to have you on the show.
Good morning, Katrina, and good morning to all our televiewers and listeners. Thank you for having me on the program.
All right, Attorney, your camp's reaction to this development in the Senate, will the pastor submit himself to authorities who will serve the arrest warrant?
Well, first of all, we respect the decision of the Senate. And but of course, Pastor Quiboloy will exert all available legal remedies to protect his constitutional rights. Now, as to the pending arrest, that's the personal decision already of Pastor Quiboloy. No? We have given him enough legal advice on how to deal with the issue. So at the end of the day, it's going to be his decision.
And when you say you have given him legal advice and that his camp will exert all efforts or to address these legal issues, what advice did you actually give the pastor?
Well, we explained to him the legal position why he should not attend the Senate hearings. No, first of all, it brazenly violated his constitutional Bill of Rights. No, as you are all very much aware, the Senate hearing is tantamount to usurpation of judicial authority. No, and any and all proceedings being made thereon is virtually trampling upon the Bill of Rights of the pastor. No. So he cannot cross-examine the witnesses. He cannot scrutinize the statements. So the affidavits, as every lawyer knows, is a mere scrap of paper if it does not undergo any form of cross-examination. So these are, among other legal ramifications, we explained to the pastor his rights, no, under the Senate hearing investigation. Now, with the warrant of arrest already issued, again, it's up to him, no, on how he would want to deal with the said order of detention.
All right. Attorney, Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri earlier mentioned that they also tried to have back channel talks with the pastor and his camp. Why didn't that prosper? Why? What was missing during that discussion? Why weren't senators actually able to convince the pastor to attend the Senate investigations?
Well, first of all, I'm not aware of any form of back channeling. No? Apart from the fact that there were suggestions that he appear, and through, I think, Senator Robin Padilla and Senator J.B. Ejercito. Apart from that, I have no personal knowledge as to any specific kind of back channeling which was done by the Honorable Senate President Zubiri.
All right. I understand that your camp is quite bent on not allowing or discouraging, at least, the pastor from attending the Senate inquiries. While your camp can easily snub these congressional investigations, what you cannot simply brush off are show cause orders from a court, arrest warrants issued by courts. I understand that there are at least three pending. Let's talk about that one by one. First, a non-bailable human trafficking case against Pastor Quiboloy filed in a Pasig City court. Your thoughts on that, Attorney?
Oh, first of all, Katrina, I'm not the lawyer handling those cases. No? As I've said many times before, my representation is limited to the Senate hearings and probably if and when there is already an extradition treaty. No? So again, going back to your initial statement, let me be clear about the fact that the pastor has never disrespected or snubbed the Senate hearings. No? We were just saying that the pastor cannot be duped into appearing in a trial by publicity. No? So all these things combined with the clear statements or categorical statements of no less than the chairman of the committee that the pastor is already guilty, no, of the crimes being leveled against him is well enough, no, would be enough reason for us to discourage the pastor from appearing therein, no, because you know the Senate is not the dispenser of justice in this country. Only the courts, no, can declare the guilt or innocence of Pastor Quiboloy. In fact, we were even saying that even if there are friends of the senator of Pastor Quiboloy who would eventually clear him, again, that would not hold water, no, because the only legitimate agency of the government which cannot clear or convict the pastor would be the judiciary, no.
Right. And speaking of the judiciary, as mentioned earlier, there are also several cases filed against him in several courts, aside from the one in the Pasig City. Just for the information of our viewers, he also has child abuse cases in Davao City with a bail for sexual assault against children amounting to 180,000 pesos and a bail for maltreatment against children for 80,000 pesos. As you mentioned, you are not in charge of these cases, but are you at least privy as to how the pastor is taking in the stack of legal cases against him?
Oh, as we previously mentioned, Katrina, that is the proper procedure, right? Because by then, the executive already is executing the laws. Remember that these charges are already covered by existing laws and special laws, no? And therefore, it is the most appropriate procedure, no? That should have been done, no? The Department of Justice, as the executive branch of our government, should lodge the cases before the judiciary, no? So the judiciary, in turn, will hear the evidence on both sides, no? And after weighing all these pieces of evidence, that's the only time that the judiciary could come out with a legitimate judgment, no? In contrast with what is going on in the Senate. If you will notice, what's going on in the Senate is that, you know, they are parading witnesses with masks, now with aliases, and there's no way for us to really identify their legitimate names. And we cannot even ask them questions, no? And again, the pastor is already being convicted even before the Senate hearing started. So these are all our serious apprehensions, which are brazenly violating the presumption of innocence, the constitutional right of the pastor to be presumed innocent until proven guilty. So it's going to be a useless exercise, Katrina.
All right, attorney, walk us through what can potentially happen once the Senate Sergeant at Arms serves the arrest warrant for Pastor Apollo Quiboloy expected today. What will happen? How will his supporters, how will his camp actually deal with this? Is there any guarantee that the chaos will not ensue in the camp from the camp of Apollo Quiboloy?
Again, Katrina, I cannot speculate, no, on what's going to happen. As I said at the very outset, it's going to be a personal decision on the part of Pastor Quiboloy, no? So, of course, as a lawyer and as a citizen, I would not want any form of anarchy or disorder or even bloodshed to occur by reason of the arrest order on the part of the pastor.
All right. Attorney, can you guarantee that Pastor Quiboloy is still in the Philippines?
Oh, I am most certain that he's still in the Philippines. As I said, he is more than willing to appear, provided it is in the proper forum, that is before the courts, not in the Senate, where trial by publicity, as many people have mentioned, no? Political scientists, legal expert, no? Would declare that it's a trial by publicity. No? If and when proper cases are lodged in court, then that's the proper time for the pastor to appear and face his charges and face his accusers face to face.
All right. He is willing to appear before a local court. What about a court from overseas? We all know that in November 2021, the FBI has issued an arrest warrant against Pastor Quiboloy, and they have recently unsealed that, perhaps as a precursor to an impending request for extradition.
Again, based on our extradition treaty, there are certain processes, Katrina, no? As long as these processes are observed, we guarantee you that the pastor will recognize that, no? Not through the Senate hearings, no? So as long as the treaty, which was signed by the Philippines and the U.S. government, is followed, then we will face all these charges arising from those.
For extradition, we'll first have to go through the Department of Foreign Affairs. And once the Department of Foreign Affairs accepts that, it will then be forwarded to the Department of Justice before the Philippine government can actually make a decision on whether or not to turn over the pastor to federal authorities of the United States. How are you preparing your client for this legal battle?
Well, of course, we will prepare as they come, Katrina. And again, at this juncture, we cannot disclose our legal strategy at that. But the basic point is, as long as there is due process being observed, the rules on evidence are strictly applied, okay, the accusers come face to face with the pastor, then we will face all forms of charges.
And what measures is your camp taking to appeal to the government to at least not turn over the pastor to U.S. authorities and instead hear his cases here in the Philippines first?
Well, of course, it is our thinking that the Philippine government should have first crack, no, so to speak, on trying the good pastor here in the Philippines, no. But then again, at the end of the day, it's going to be the decision of the Philippine government and the trial court or the judiciary if they will allow the pastor to be tried in a foreign land through the extradition treaty.
Frankly speaking, the pastor is good friends with the Duterte family. Have you tried to speak with Vice President Sara Duterte with regard to his possible extradition?
Well, I don't know the Vice President personally, and I don't think at this point she should be involved. No? Everything here that, as far as my representation is concerned, are purely based on our legal position. No? The violation of the constitutional rights of Pastor Quiboloy. As to the political underpinnings or dimensions, I don't think I have business in dealing with that, Katrina.
All right. You have been repeatedly mentioning that the pastor's constitutional rights have been violated by the Senate, that he has been, certain rights of his were not being honored by the chamber. Do you actually plan to file an official case, a formal case, before any court to uphold or to push for the rights of the pastor?
Oh, that's a very nice question, Katrina. That is precisely part of the template, no, that we're going to take in the coming days, no? So I would assume that at the end of the day, it's going to be the judiciary who is going to interpret the constitutional limitations on the power of the Congress to conduct investigations, and that's limited, no, by the provisions of the Constitution, that the rights of affected resource persons, especially to their life, property, and liberty, should be respected.
But will you actually file a case in the coming days? Is it safe to say, fair to say, that you will question the Congress's right to actually hold or call over certain people to their investigations in aid of legislation?
Yes, I think, Katrina, that's part of the process allowed under our existing laws, and that's a very big possibility that we will elevate the matter before the appropriate courts.
Which appropriate court, sir, just for our information?
Well, it could be before the Supreme Court, under Rule 65, no, of our rules of court, no?
All right. We are trying to get a few questions from our Senate reporters here, and we will be waiting for that if it comes just in time for the show. With regard to that case you are planning to file before the Supreme Court, what are the basic arguments? What are the key arguments that your camp plans to actually argue before the court in favor of the pastor?
Well, again, just a disclosure, Katrina. I'm not even sure if I'm going to be the lawyer, no, who's going to file that before the Supreme Court. But basically, as I mentioned to you, just like in other cases whereby the resource persons would elevate these cases before the Supreme Court, you have the case of Ong, the case of Neri. I think based the constitutional limitations would be the subject, no, of the possible inquiry on the part of the Supreme Court.
All right, attorney.
And of course, if I may just add, Katrina,
go ahead.
I think for my part, I noticed that the decision or the ruling made by the committee was only signed by Senator Ontiveros. I think the committee is supposed to be a collegial body. And we have never heard of the other members of the committee, whether or not, they dissent or they concur with the said committee hearings. To us, I think, Katrina, that is very significant because it would appear that the committee is solely being controlled by Senator Antiperos, and for that matter, the entire Senate, without even us hearing any opinion on the part of the other senators, especially the members of the committee. I think that's a significant factor that we have to stress at this juncture, that it would appear that only Senator Ontiveros came out with the said ruling.
If that is your concern, would the pastor be more amenable to attending congressional hearings should other senators speak up regarding this issue?
Well, again, that is another speculative, and I would not know, no, if that would be the position of Pastor Quiboloy. As I said, Katrina, the root cause of this was the resolution already convicting, no, Pastor Quiboloy of the certain crimes, of serious crimes, upon which he is being accused.
Okay, I get the sentiment that I get the impression that you feel that the pastor will be treated unfairly should the committee of Senator Rizon Tiveros hear his case. But what if other senators open another inquiry, a separate inquiry, with regard to the pastor's issue? Will you be more amenable to attending that hearing?
Well, again, Katrina, it depends on the manner, no, or the parameters upon which that inquiry is being presented to us, no? Unlike the Senate resolution, which was authored by Senator Ontiveros, which already held him guilty, no? That is very different. Again, it depends on the kind of resolution upon which the senators would come up with, no? And that remains to be seen what kind of hearing we will be having later on, Katrina.
With all due respect, sir, are you looking for a more friendly court?
It's not so much a friendly court, Katrina, but a forum whereby the Bill of Rights of Pastor Quiboloy is respected, and in a proper forum. No? As I said, if you take in totality all these circumstances, it is very, very clear that the pastor is being tried in public, no? Because no less than the chairperson himself said, you will allow me to quote, ha? Mga kaibigan, there is one thing that needs to be said amidst all the noise. The crimes for which Pastor Apollo Quiboloy stands accused, both in the United States and here in the Philippines, are taking place as we speak. Meaning to say, crimes are being committed. Now, under our laws, if that's the case, he should be arrested already. And let me add, ang hiningi po natin ay managot na si Quiboloy para maligtas ang mga iba pang biktima na nasa kanyang mga poder, unquote. So it only goes to show that, you know, the purpose of the Senate hearing is no longer to come out with any kind of legislation, but to try the good pastor by reason of these accusations and be the judge, no, on the part of the Senate. That we cannot allow, Katrina, because it goes into the very heart of the constitutional Bill of Rights of Pastor Quiboloy. So if that is going to be the scenario that the Senate or the Congress would be coming out in the future, I don't think we will take a different position.
Right. So that basically means that the pastor is not inclined to heed the arrest warrant that will be served to him today, because once he accepts, or once he receives that warrant, once he is taken to the Senate, then basically he is already there and will no longer be protected from, or will not be no longer be protected from attending those hearings. Your thoughts, attorney, with regard to observations that your client is somehow close to becoming a fugitive?
Well, again, these are all speculative, Katrina, no? So again, that it's going to be his personal decision on how to deal with the matter, no? If you call it fugitive, I think that's a misnomer, no? Because he has not been convicted of any crime. Remember, he's being ordered detained because simply of the Senate hearings, no? So no crime has even been proven beyond reasonable doubt convicting the good pastor. So it's going to be a misnomer if he's a fugitive from justice, no? Because when you say he's a fugitive from justice, it must be the courts, no? Who should be running after him, not the Senate.
Right.
He's supposed to craft legislation, no? So if the hearings are seriously meant to come out with new laws, then that's a different story altogether, Katrina.
All right. Attorney, Senate reporters are asking that are saying that there is also a possibility to expand the investigation to Pastor Quiboloy's and the Kingdom of Jesus Christ's assets through the AMLC. Your thoughts on that?
Oh, again, Katrina, these are all part of the privileges and powers of the Congress, no? As long as these hearings are conducted within the limits of the Constitution, we cannot question that, no? That's the power, part of the power and prerogative of the Congress or the Senate in particular. What we are only asserting is that the fundamental Bill of Rights of resource persons or those being investigated are properly protected and respected. Because you know, respect begets respect.
And you don't think that your client was given due process, given that the Senate issued several summons, but both of which he snubbed?
Certainly not. Again, let me stress, Katrina, if you will allow me to read the exact wordings of the Senate resolution. It says here, no? This was written by the Senate Committee Chairperson, open quote, whereas considering that the crimes were committed within the territorial jurisdiction of the Philippines and considering that the crimes are taking place even at present, as Quiboloy remains free to run the operations of KOJC, it is imperative that an investigation be undertaken with dispatch, unquote. So again, it's very clear. No less than the committee already declared the conviction or the guilt of Pastor Quiboloy, and that he's already committing. To our minds, if that's the case, that's within the powers already of the judiciary or even the executive to arrest him if crimes are presently being committed, not the Senate, Katrina, which is clearly, again, I cannot overemphasize the fact that what's happening is a trial by publicity.
All right. And for now, we will have to leave it at that. But we look forward to speaking more with you, especially once your camp decides to file that case against the Senate. Thank you so much for making time for us this morning.
Katrina,
Attorney Elvis Balayan.
Good morning.